Hello, everybody, and welcome to a podcast by random people you probably don't know. And we're going to be talking about Jack London's book, Call of the Wild. We have questions here set up about people called him a nature faker, and we're going to ask questions about that and have a discussion about that. And then we're going to also have a discussion about animal rights groups, because back then, dogs were treated poorly. They were whipped, beaten, killed.
Starved.
Starved. Thank you, random co-host.
You're welcome.
So, the co-host, Ashlyn, is going to be the critic. I'm going to be the supporter of Jack London's book, Call of the Wild, and I'm going to be defending him if he was alive here. I'm going to be acting like I was him. And so we're going to start. So, first question. Do you think Jack intentionally meant to get all this negative attention? Personally, I don't think he really thought about it when he went to go and make this book. I think he just kind of was like, I want to go make a dog book, and I have the dog die at the end.
Well, personally, I think that my opinion is pretty much the same as my co-host here. When he went to write this book, he was like, oh, I'm going to write a dog book. And then the dog's not going to die. Wonderful. But when he went to make this book, I don't think he was thinking at all. These animals, they can't have feelings like this. They don't have enough brain power to think like this.
So you're saying that Jack London, everybody thinks that dogs do not have enough brain power and that they're stupid, and Jack London was giving them...
Jack London was giving them rights that they shouldn't have had.
I think he was giving them intelligence, which in some cases dogs do show that they have, but some dogs, like my dog, is really stupid. He can't get a blanket off his head. He just sits there and lays down. So you're right in a way, but I don't think you're right completely. So, second question. What do you think would have happened if Jack intentionally meant to be a nature faker? I don't think he intentionally meant to be one. This kind of goes with our last question. But I think that I don't think that term was really even around when he was alive, because he wrote this book in, like, what, 1800s?
1800s or
ish,
so.
Ish area. Don't know exactly when. But I don't think that term was around then, and he wasn't really... I think people just read books more back then as entertainment, and they wanted them to be fictional, and they weren't really thinking about when they were alive, or if they had intentional thoughts. Not 1800s, I'm sorry, it's 1903. Woohoo, I can fly now. But, yeah, what's your opinion?
My opinion is that I think he intentionally meant to be a nature faker. There was no way that he actually believed this, because in the period of time that he lived in, these dogs were not treated very well. And so I think he intentionally meant to be a nature faker to attract attention and get money for his book, maybe being a little greedy.
I don't think he really meant to get that much money for his book. I think he was just trying to be an author. Yeah, he's probably just like, yeah, I'm going to make money off this book, but I also just want to write it because I want to write a book about dogs that don't die. Yeah, next question. What is your personal opinion on Jack London's success with this book? I think that he wanted to be successful, and he didn't want to be unsuccessful, and he didn't want to lose money on printing and publishing, but I think he really wanted this book to be a success and wanted it to be a classic. Your opinion?
I honestly don't think that Jack London should have received that much credit for this book, because the book was well written, but it wasn't really a great plot line. Like, the ending wasn't very good. And at the time, Jack London didn't make very much, but now the animal rights groups have come in and all other kinds of animal supporters, Jack London has got so much success with this book, if he'd still be alive. But I really don't think he should have got this much recognition.
I don't think he was really getting attention. I think he was getting more hate than he got love on this book when the animal rights groups came in. But, yeah. So, next question. Do you think dogs have rights in this time and age? What do you think it was like for them back then before animal rights groups came about? I think dogs have rights in this time and age because we see it as today as don't hurt the dogs, because, you know, we see them as human beings and we see them as carers, or not carers, but they do save our lives, so we we kind of want to save theirs. We have animal shelters. We have no-kill shelters. Kill shelters are kind of frowned upon by animal rights groups. But back then, before animal rights groups, I think they were treated like an animal. They were treated like livestock. They were slaughtered. Well, not really slaughtered for meat, but they were killed unnecessarily because they wouldn't do their work. Like, in this book, a lot of dogs die because, you know, they don't care, and they do care about them, but they die because the people don't want to take responsibility for a dog that is almost dying or dead, so they just kill it. And when animal rights groups came around, that changed completely. They made the laws to where you cannot just flat out kill a dog just because you don't want to take care of it. It's frowned upon.
I think that dogs do have rights in this time because us Americans spend over $60 billion on our pets a year. So there has to be some sort of right, because without these rights, it would have been like the 1800s where we didn't spend just about any money on these pets. And now that the animal rights groups have come around, I think that $60 billion is sort of, well, say, come in with the animal rights groups, because the animal rights groups are enforcing, you could say, right treatment of animals. But so then that $60 billion comes into play.
You have a really good point, and I don't think I can argue with that. And that's a bad thing. So something tells me you win that argument. Do you think the amount of money that Jack London got for his book was reasonable? I think that it was, because, you know, when it first came out, I'm assuming, I don't really have information in front of me, I'm assuming that he actually did get some money, but it wasn't like nowadays where the first book of Harry Potter comes out and, oh, this book's really good, and then the second book comes out and it does ridiculously well.
I think he got somewhere around $300 maybe, and then someone bought it off of him for $2,000 later.
Yeah, well, $300, that's maybe like, I'm going to guess.
That was a lot back in the
day. Yeah, I'm going to say if it was like a dollar per copy, it's 300 copies right there.
Yeah.
Not as much as, you know, they're selling today. I mean,
Look at Rick Riordan and J.K. Rowling, how they're making all this money just writing books for a living.
Yeah, and then it encourages, well, I feel like I'm getting off track here. But I think it was, you know, reasonable for the time that he was in. I feel like it was a really good book, and it was well written. Arguing with you, I feel like it had a good plot line. It had a good ending. I feel like that was the right ending that we should have gotten.
At the time, the amount of money that he got for his book might not have been reasonable, because back then, as I said before, that was a lot of money. Like $300 or $2,000 was a lot of money back in the 1800s. But nowadays, I don't think that amount would have been very reasonable, because people make so much money for their books now. And if Jack London were alive, he wouldn't be on like the top 10 bestseller, New York Times bestseller lists. Because I've talked to people before, and they've told me, oh, I've never heard of that book before, or, oh, is that a good book? They've never heard of it, so he might not have been very popular.
Maybe back then he was a lot more popular, and he would have gotten a lot more money.
Because of, like, the outrage from everyone about...
Yeah, probably. He probably got a lot of recognition from that, but, you know, today it doesn't seem like a lot.
Yeah.
Because, you know, it's an old book. People don't like old books because we're cruel, heartless children. No, not really. Just some of us. Some of us. Yeah. No names. But, next question. How do you think the circle of compassion has changed throughout the years? Personally, I do not know what the circle of compassion is, so I'm going to let you start.
Okay, so the circle of compassion is how the dogs were treated. Like, in the book, Mercedes was yelling at Hal not to whip the dogs, or she wouldn't go with him. And so the circle of compassion has extremely expanded. It's It's a very wide variety now because dogs are companions, they're friends, and they're family members. So the circle of compassion has evolutionized, you could say, a lot throughout the years since the 1800s.
I can't really say much about this because I really don't know what it is. It seems like a Christ group, from my opinion, and what I'm seeing on the webpage. And it seems like a group that just wants people to stop killing animals and slaughtering them. Because I know that animal slaughterhouses are really bad conditions. Like, they're just shoved in a pen with thousands of them all in one group. So I feel like what they want to do is just literally take the animals and put them in an open pasture and bring them in and kill them humanely. Mm-hmm. From what that I'm sound that's what it sounds like to me. And it seems like they want to stop animal cruelty towards dogs, cats, rabbits, chicken, any kind of
just any animal.
Any animal that's allowed in like a city to you have as a pet. So I don't really know how it's changed throughout the years. A lot. I mean, I feel like it would be expanded to more animals because more animals get killed. And I'm looking at the webpage and I'm actually kind of surprised because I did not know rabbits were killed for meat or slaughtered for meat. I mean, I knew sheep, cattle, pigs, duck, turkeys, chickens were, but I didn't know about rabbits. How could you kill something so fluffy?
I have something to add there. There have been rumors going around about the Iditarod, how the Iditarod breeders are like puppy mills. And how
those are disgusting.
How some of the puppies are like runts or too weak, and they just tie them up in a plastic bag and throw them in a river.
Yeah, I feel like that's what they kind of want to stop, because you know that's cruel and heartless. They should take it into an arms and feed it, make it a nurtured baby puppy, baby puppy. Don't even start it. I know everybody's gonna quote that ad. Don't even do it. Do you think Jack London should write more dog books or more books about animals? I think so because, you know, in my opinion, Call of the Wild was a great book. I liked it. You know, if you've ever read the Warrior series by, Aaron Hunter, that was a good book. And those were about, Survivors is about dogs. There's one about bears. There's the cat one. But yeah, those were really good books, and I feel like Jack London, if he wrote a series like that, it would turn out really good, because I like his writing style. Not really so much the way he puts, like, the Northerners' voices in, because I can't really understand all the French ones, because they talk in a weird accent, and he shows that accent on the book pages.
They're like, "Dat buck fight like two devils,
Yeah, exactly, and it's just like, no, I can't stand that. I have to, like, skip over it and try to...
And try to read it in English?
Yes. Yeah, but I do think he should write more books. I feel like he would be very successful. I mean, yes, I know he's dead, but if he was alive, he should write more books.
Personally, I think that if Jack London were alive today, like Adam said, he would be more successful because everybody's reading that kind of stuff nowadays, like Warriors and, The Golden Compass. Is that what I'm thinking? Yeah. Golden Compass.
I didn't really like that book series.
Yeah.
I tried to read it and it was really bad.
Off topic. Hang on. So, personally, Call of the Wild was a good read for me, but I think that Jack London went a little too into detail about the murder scenes in this book because, well, Buck tearing out someone's jugular and then blood spurting forth from his throat.
What are you talking about? The Warrior series was just as bloody.
I didn't read the Warrior series.
No.
I didn't. I've never
read it.
Read
it now. Get out. Go read it now.
Anyways. On to the next question.
Yeah. Do you think... This goes along with the last question again. Do you think he should have wrote a sequel to Call of the Wild? I think so. I think it would have been a really good book. Like, maybe have it follow the cub or puppy... animal, whatever you call it, thing of Buck, maybe if he had a child, not him, but his mate. If he had a child with, oh my god, I can't talk.
With one of the Timberwolves?
Yes, follow that story and maybe have it go back and find maybe him, he, the puppy, follow the legacy of Buck, and have him go back and try to find his old master, try to go find something along the lines of that. But, yeah, I feel like it would be a really good book if he followed something like that, or along the lines of that, or maybe follow the pack itself. Maybe have something like, I know Ender's Game, Orson Scott Card wrote a lot of books about the other people in Ender's squad.
About his captain and about getting ice thrown back to Earth.
Yeah. I didn't really read a lot of those, but I did read Secrets of the Dead. Not Secrets of the Dead, Ender's Exile. That was a really good book. But, you know, your opinion on this one?
My opinion is that I think I will agree with Adam on this one. The ending was pretty bad in a way, I guess you could say. But if Jack London had wrote a sequel to Call of the Wild, and it was about, like, Buck living with the Timberwolves and what he experiences, or maybe, like Adam said, following his cub around, or maybe about the man in the red sweater. Maybe it could be about the man in the red sweater and Buck finally getting his revenge.
Or maybe, like, it followed the human's point of view instead of Buck's point of view.
Yeah, or it could follow the human's point of view and how they felt about treating the animals this way.
Maybe they did feel guilty.
So I will agree with Adam on this one and say, yes, he should have wrote a sequel.
Yeah, I do feel like the end of the book, it had, imagine like a fishing line.
It had its good points, but then it had its bad points.
Yeah, imagine like a fishing line with a bunch of hooks on it that could lead to sequels. Like, Call of the Wild is the fishing line, and the hooks are possible sequels. I feel like it had a lot of those at the ending. Mm-hmm. Like, you could have done a lot of different things with that book.
Next question. Do you think that Jack London elicited too much empathy for the dogs? Let you start on this one.
I think at the time people probably thought, wow, this guy, he must be Tom of Bedlam. Like, insane. There is no way that these dogs have these feelings and these brains at the time. But,
because, you know, everybody thinks that everybody's stupid back then because they're all stupid back then.
Yeah, exactly. So at the time, they might have thought, yeah, he elicited way too much empathy for these dogs. There's no way that any of us would feel this way, except for maybe you, Jack London. But...
Loner.
Yeah. But now, this is normal. People are always eliciting empathy for animals. Like, you see the ASPCA commercials, and you're like, oh, the poor puppies, or the poor cats. They're getting abused. And
I feel like those videos are scripted. I really do.
Yeah, those
to get more attention.
But, anyways, topic. It's like those ASPCA commercials, like I said, they're eliciting empathy for the animals, and that's okay now in this modern century. But back when Jack London was alive and he wrote this book, that wasn't so okay. Because everybody, like, beat their dogs to make them listen.
Yeah, I do feel like, I don't think he elicited too much empathy, but back then, yeah, he kind of did. Because, you know, they whipped the dogs to get them moving. That's harmful to them. But today, I'm going to agree with her. Yeah, he didn't elicit too much empathy in today's world and thinking. But back then, yeah, he did. Because, you know, people are cruel. And the world's cruel and cold and heartless and mean. Why do you think that people thought Jack London was a nature figure? I think that people thought this because, you know, they're all jerks back then. End of story. But not really. But, I think they thought that he was like that because, you know, back then people probably thought, this is just me guessing, people probably thought that, you know, when they do autopsies on people, the size of their brain reflects how smart they are. So, dogs, they don't have a very big brain. It's about the size of a small dinner plate. Well, not really a small dinner plate, but maybe smaller than our brains. They probably thought that dogs were really stupid, and they couldn't have this kind of feeling. But Jack London probably was not like that. He was probably thinking, you know, maybe dogs are smart. Maybe think, and maybe they have human feelings because, you know, we don't really have a way of thinking, oh, dogs have special dog emotions. They speak their own special dog language. We just thought back then that, you know, dogs think human stuff, and humans are the rulers of the world, so everybody thinks human. Because that's how the world works. Worldly stuff. Okay.
Okay, I think that Jack London was called a nature faker, that people thought that he was a nature faker, because going along with Adam's point here, people were extremely cruel to their animals, and they had no compassion and no care when it came to these animals. So they might have thought he was a nature faker for putting these impossible things into these dogs' heads, or maybe giving these dogs emotions or thoughts that were human-like and not more dog-like. But no, you couldn't know because it's not like we could see into the brain of the dog.
Not like we can morph into a dog and be like, oh, this is how dogs feel all the time. No. Do you think that some of these people would have been attacked or verbally and written by animal rights groups about how they treated their dogs?
I will just go ahead and say yes.
Yeah, I think we agree on this one, just flat out yes.
These animal rights groups people would have been absolutely ticked.
They would be like, how dare you whip these dogs? How dare you beat them with a club?
They would have been so...
just angry.
They've been so ticked at these guys because they're like, beat them to make them listen and whip them to make them listen. Like, Hal went and almost killed Buck because he couldn't get up because he was so malnourished. And this animals' rights activist would have just gone nuts.
Yeah, I think you've stole most of the words out of my mouth. You know, that was our last question. I think that this was a pretty successful podcast, and I think that, you know, hope you guys like it, and we'll talk to you guys soon if we do another one. You don't know. Maybe if you guys like it, we'll do another one. I don't know. But, yep. Bye. See ya.